Aloha, this is Bill Best once again with On Exhibit. And today we're way up country, right near Grandma's, to visit the Kingswood Fine Furniture Workshop with Peter Naramore.
Hi,
good
Bill.
To see you.
Nice to see you too.
Always.
Thanks for coming up.
And we're going to find out how to make a chair. Yeah, because if you could look around his workshop here, there are dozens of chairs, and he doesn't just work on chairs. He works on cabinets. And is there nothing you don't make out of wood?
Pretty much. But if it's wood, I'll try it. You know.
Have you ever made a wooden refrigerator?
No, there's one I'm still waiting to have the commission come in for.
Oh, really?
I don't think I'd make one on spec, though.
Well, you know, this studio, this is like any man's dream studio or workshop. I mean, if you ever wanted a woodworking shop, this would be it. And you've got some amazing machines in here and some wonderful pieces of, like this table here is like nothing I've ever seen. Did you build this table?
Yes, I made. This is a classic woodworking bench. The designs go back to probably 15th or 16th century.
This is from... This is really.
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't know if he's.
No, I'm not joking. The idea of this tape. It's a very heavy bench, so you put your work on it, and when you plane or chop or cut, it doesn't move.
It doesn't move. Yeah.
And it's got this movable section right here. You clamp something in, like this is a chair arm, that I'm working on right here.
I see. And it's kind of like a vise.
It is a vise, and it holds the piece, so it's firmly held. You see, you can work on it.
Yeah.
So it's actually primarily. Important tool for anybody who wants to do serious woodworking. And I built this about 30 years ago or so. And I've been in the business my whole life, woodworking my whole life professionally. And this, I figure I built this about 20 years later than I should have. This should be the first thing you make if you're a woodworker because...
you need a good table to
work
on.
All sorts of people, you hold things down with clamps or you screw things down. It's stupid. This should be the first thing you make once you decide you know what you're doing.
Well, the chairs that you have... are really amazing to look at. They seem to be made out of a number of different kinds of woods.
Yeah, that's a series of chairs. Those are all rocking chairs. As you can see, they've got the curved rockers in the bottom, but they are all actually slightly different grades. Most of them are different grades of koa. This is koa. These are all koa.
Oh, these are all koa.
All these ones in the front.
Even the light one?
No.
Oh, okay.
This is maple.
Didn't think so. Maple. That's kind of the kind of maple that they make guitars out of.
Guitar necks and guitars, yes, curly maple.
Beautiful, curly
maple. Stuff,
yep.
And that's a type of walnut that grew actually on Maui. It's called Claro walnut. It's a very, very highly desirable, beautiful wood also. So three of these pieces are sold. This is commissioned by somebody who saw another one I made identical to this on my website, and they ordered one. So that got me back. And then that one and that one are... also sold to people. So
even though they're not finished, they know that this is going to be a masterpiece. And
they have faith. As
well,
I was
saying
earlier, I've made hundreds of pieces of furniture in my lifetime, and very often it just takes a person coming in this workshop after seeing my websites or pictures, whatever, and they come in the workshop and they have the faith that I can build what I say I can build. Have a seat, Bill. Very carefully. Sit.
A little dusty.
Sorry about that. There's dust everywhere. Just
sit
very carefully because it's not glued together yet.
Great.
But just lean back. It's okay. You're all right. It's a comfortable chair, is it not?
It's very comfortable.
Yeah. So, like I say, there won't be any more carved rockers like these. These aren't going to be carved. They're going to be just... Uh-oh. It has that effect on people sometimes.
It does. Rocking chairs. And, you know, Kennedy had a rocking chair, and it was good for his back. They say that rocking is... Well, I better not rock too much.
You can rock a little bit. It's not glued together, but it's not going to fall apart either.
Well, this is the kind of furniture that you would hand down from...
Yeah, it's an heirloom piece.
An heirloom piece,
yeah,
absolutely.
They're
and
not,
I think from what, from what I've seen, most of your work is heirloom quality.
Well, perhaps. I guess you could say that. I mean, there's just no sense in doing things... less than that for me. I mean, I may have made hundreds of pieces, but I probably don't have hundreds more pieces in my future.
Yeah.
You know, if I'm lucky, who knows, maybe. But at this point, I think, and it has been this way for a long time, why waste my time with anything but something that is the very best I can make?
Sure, absolutely.
So that's what I do. And it's, you know, there's a real market for that. I'm very fortunate to live in a time and a place where people can afford this sort of thing and want it.
And craftsmanship of this type is not that common anymore. I mean,
well, you may be surprised how it's growing in popularity. There are many schools around the country. When I began doing this, I just actually right out of high school at 17 years old, I began a self-guided apprenticeship with different men and companies that I worked for. There was nowhere to get an education in this kind of thing. I mean, there was one school. It was actually, oddly enough, from the town I hail from, which is Rochester, New York. There was the American School of Craftsmen. I applied to that school when I was 17. They took six students a year, and they said they were filled up for a couple of years. So I thought, well, the heck with that. I'll go and find my fortune in the world by myself. But back then, that was it. I mean, you could maybe find somebody who had an uncle or, you know, like I did, and friends who could teach you a bit. But really, not like it is. I mean, today, I'm sure there are dozens and dozens of schools in the country. I know there are. Plus, every college has got a extension program that involves woodworking and furniture making, not just like the shop in eighth grade that we all did.
Yeah, perhaps, yeah. You know, I made an ashtray when I was in eighth grade.
Yeah, most everyone did. But I'm talking about furniture program, serious people doing, men and women alike.
We have some wonderful woodworkers here on Maui and a guild, as a matter of fact, if people don't know that.
Right, the Maui Woodworkers Guild, several of us got together and began that about, 12, 13, 14 years ago. And it's still limping along, and I say limping because it's really come down to myself and two other people to keep it going. But as a very recent project, we brought in a very fine, internationally renowned woodworker who is a marquetry expert.
Oh, wonderful.
Marquetry is...
I'm fascinated by marquetry.
But most people don't know what it is. I mean, I mentioned it to many, many people who they said, marquetry, what's that? And I was a little surprised. But so marquetry is basically pictures of wood in wood. It's not inlaying the pieces into a plank or something. That's called inlay. But marquetry is pictures built out of pieces of veneer, really.
Can you show us a couple of examples?
I have I'm also an antiques dealer and a purveyor. This is an old piece I found. You know, somebody probably did this at their kitchen table, would be my guess.
Oh, really?
Yeah, these are all different wood grains. They're probably about a 16th or less of an inch thick. It's actually signed with a burning, so this person may not have been a complete amateur, but many people do it just for fun because it's not that difficult. You don't need that much space or tools.
There's a rooster.
It's a great picture.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
I would have wished to have a little more contrast from everything because it's a little difficult to make out.
It's all woody. It's very woody.
It's very woody.
Yeah, this is another piece of marquetry. This is an antique or vintage, probably within the 20th century. And it is a picture I rather like.
Yeah.
Done in the same style as the last one I showed you, but maybe a little bit more artistic. You know, the person... used different, this is probably ebony, and this is some other wood that, actually, I haven't touched it. You can see it's kind of got spots and it's all sort of messed up, but...
I kind of like that.
I kind of like it, too. You know, I don't want it. But if I sanded it lightly or cleaned it up, I'm sure you'd see a huge contrast in these woods. So, I collect marquetry pieces because I'm in the antiques business, but also just because as a woodworker, I respect a lot of what's come before. And it's marquetry itself is I believe it's a French word. It certainly sounds like it. But the marquetry tradition really began in a big way in Italy in the 16th century. And they were very, very into it there. But you can even see examples of marquetry going back to the pharaoh's tombs in Egypt 4,000 years ago.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, so people were cutting veneers and doing things with it back then.
Yeah.
And but I think it reached its zenith, perhaps, in France. Again, I have a great deal of respect for the French tradition of woodworking in general. Marquetry is one of the things that they have never stopped doing. So anyway, this man who came recently and gave us a class, a three-day workshop. Mm-hmm. We turned this room into a school, basically. We built two 16-foot-long tables, and we had 10 students. And he, it being my shop, I was sort of his assistant because I've done a lot of marquetry, but he was the master that we brought. Paul Schirsch is his name. He's a Swiss-American guy, quite well-known in the world of woodworking and marquetry. Probably not familiar to most people here, though. But
no.
So this was a class for totally entry-level. It was a fantastic opportunity for anybody who wants to learn how to do marquetry and the techniques. And this man was a powerhouse. I mean, the energy he put out was, it was 11 hours a day for 3 days of the class. And everyone, you know, wasn't even sleeping that first night because they were so overloaded with information.
Really? Yeah.
So I managed to do a piece during that class. And it's not quite finished, actually. But this is a piece that I built during the class, and this is, it's going to be worked into a tabletop. And it's, as you can see perhaps, it's a koi pond or koi fish looking from above with the mm-hmm. lily pads and whatnot. And so it'll be worked into a small coffee table.
Now, are these tinted or?
No, these are natural color. This is a very unusually strongly colored poplar. Huh. So I think it's European poplar of some sort. Yeah. So, I mean, that people do use dyed mm-hmm. woods. I mean, somebody was doing something out of this. Here's just a piece I found on the floor after the class. I mean, that is not a natural color wood of any sort, you see. That's how thick they are, you see. It's like the thickness of cardboard.
Uh-oh.
Oops, doesn't matter. Anyway.
Uh-oh.
But... So anyway, this is something I'm doing, a project that I built.
So would you finish that with other colors or a lacquer?
Oh, yeah. This is just raw wood. So it'll really have a lot more contrast.
So it'll just jump out.
It will. And, you know, it's going to be worked into a coffee table, actually, with a large border around the outside.
That'll be spectacular.
And maybe some sculptured fish or reeds, or I'm not sure what it'll be for legs. And, it'll be a piece that... I'll probably wind up putting in my my gallery, which I have.
Yeah, your gallery. Let's talk about that, because you have a shop on right there on Baldwin Avenue in Makawao.
Right.
A wonderful little shop. If people want to go exploring in Makawao, don't miss Peter Naramore's shop. Well, now, you have to create pieces for people, and they order a certain piece. You've got to deal with the public, and that can't always be easy. Some people, especially wealthy people, tend to be very fussy about their stuff and what they commission you to do. So is that ever a problem?
It
probably not too much.
It was a problem more when I was younger and I didn't know how to vet people correctly or easily.
Vetting.
I mean, there are some red flags that pop up very quickly and easily with people I work for. And the number one red flag is they want it, you know, yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
That's the first thing.
And that won't work for you.
No, if they're
you
in a hurry.
You can't create something yesterday.
No one should be in a hurry for a fine piece of furniture. I mean, there is no need to get it quickly. If there is, they're talking to the wrong guy.
Well, they could go to IKEA, you know.
Sure, yeah. But a custom piece takes time. So that's the number one thing. And... you know, other things are, you know, if they start to question the price right away and make an issue about that, then we're probably going to have a problem down the line. So, yeah, I mean, I think I've become very, very careful in who I'll work for.
Yeah, sure.
As they are with me. I mean, it's kind of a mutual thing when you kind of feel each other out. You know, do I want to work for this person, and do they want me to work for them? We have to like each other. And honestly, very often that's one of the main... motivations for people having me make something. Yes, they want something made, but they want something made by someone they have a relationship with. Someone they know. Perhaps they have some input into how the design went.
That's how I feel about sandwiches.
Really?
Yeah. When I go, I want a sandwich, and you know, it's got to be just right.
But it's a smaller and a shorter relationship.
And a lot cheaper.
And it's cheaper, yes.
Because how many sandwiches could you buy for the price of, say, one of your fine chairs?
What kind of sandwiches are we talking about?
Oh, yeah, well, that would... Yeah, a Reuben? I don't know.
Yeah. Are we talking Subway sandwiches?
Yeah.
Many thousand, I think.
You know, I'm so fascinated with your workshop. Can we look at some of the equipment here? Because it's all like science fiction to me.
Okay, so the machinery I've got here, actually, everything in this shop is about the third generation for me of purchasing tools. In other words, when you start out, you get a tool you can afford, and you have limited space and budget, and then you get something a little bit better. So these tools are now as high as I aspire to own as far as the size and the quality.
So as far as this one is concerned, you started off probably with a jigsaw, right?
Exactly, a handheld jigsaw.
And now you have an Excalibur.
Well, this is
called an Excalibur.
This is made for marquetry, actually.
And oh, it is.
This is not the right blade. They also use it for cutout, but this is a beautiful tool. Those are marquetry blades.
Yes. Oh, these are blades.
These are blades. These are,
you can't even hardly see.
Nope, that's right. They're, it's about the size of a thick
like
hair.
Like a little.
They've got teeth on them. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, I can feel that. I can feel that.
So that that's a very fine tool with the foot switch and all. Now, this is a shaper.
This is a shaper. How is this different from a planer?
Well, a shaper shapes things. It's got a bearing and a giant cutter head inside there, and it's got a movable table. There it goes. So it slides back and forth like that, and you put things on here, and you this one is used mostly for cabinet making, but since I don't do much cabinet making, I use it for furniture making. This could best be described as a very, very large router table.
Oh, okay, all right.
You know what a router table is, but this has got something in there that's just, it's not plugged in, so don't worry.
Oh, you're not going to crank it up?
No, I don't think you want me to do that.
Oh, I love to hear it.
You would.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think so. It's got this giant cutter head on it. See, that's a multiple head.
Oh, my gosh.
Multiple cutter. And I use this for shaping, well, for the rocking chairs, for example. All those curved parts, you make a pattern. There's your bearing, and there's your cutter. So why this is better than a router table is because it's a very stable cut when you have a cutter of that size.
It's solid. It's
super
solid. It's not going to go anywhere.
Yes, and so because of the diameter, the thing is actually cutting in a very controlled way. All right, so this workshop, I built it with dust collection in the floor. In other words, it has all these tubes for the chips and everything are set down into the concrete and then go out to an outside building, which tell the chips go outside.
Wow. Well, so is that what this panel is here?
Yeah, so this is the switch in a couple of different places. This is actually just a very large 6-inch PVC pipe that we put into the ground before we put the pad down. You can only do that if you build a building specifically to be a workshop.
Yeah, so you did all the concrete work and everything.
Oh, I'm not proud of that, but yes, I did.
Oh, you're not.
There's cracks throughout it, but you know, we're not known for our concrete work, furniture makers. This is the latest whiz-bang thing in the woodworking world. It's called a saw stop. And this tool is just relatively new. I've had it for about 5 or 6 years, but it's taken the woodworking world by storm, because it is impossible to cut off your finger with this saw.
Why? How's that?
Well, if your finger even comes anywhere near that, or actually it has to touch it, it will instantly, while it's running, it will instantly stop the blade and lower it. In fact, I'm not going to demonstrate that
for you. No, please don't. And I did notice that you have all 10 fingers.
I do.
Which says a lot about a good woodworker.
But you see this right here?
Yeah.
Watch what happens when I touch the blade.
Oh, yeah, a little red light blinks on.
That isn't showing you much, but
Do that again?
Yeah, it senses the moisture in
that's
your
amazing.
Hand. It'll stop in like a hundredth of a second. And it actually destroys the blade, and it costs you about $150
happens. Really?
Oh. It's happened, because it destroys the blade, and it destroys the cartridge, but it saves your hand. It's happened to me a few times.
Really?
Not because I was being uncareful, but because it also doesn't like staples, moisture, things like that. So you got to be really careful what you're cutting with this. So it took us a few years to get used, because it's a very expensive way to learn. Yeah.
Is this a planer?
Actually, this is a jointer. Often confused. This is also a jointer. This is a more of a normal shop size jointer. A planer is a larger tool that takes wood down dimensionally, makes it thinner and thinner, or from rough to smooth. This is a jointer, J-O-I-N-T-E-R, because it makes an edge that can be joined, okay? In other words, if you're going to join up a bunch of boards, you can make a nice jointed edge. That's where the term jointer comes from. This is a Mondo jointer. This is like what I call a real big boy tool. This thing weighs 1 ton, 2,000 pounds. It came off of a ship that was in Pearl Harbor. And I bought it at auction, sight unseen, for $200.
Wow.
So I thought, oh, wow, what a great deal, right?
Yeah, except you got to transport it.
Not only that, we had to get it off the ship. In Pearl Harbor without power on the ship. The ship was due to be destroyed by a RIMPAC exercise, and all of these tools were going to be sunk for this ship. It was all.
No.
It was a ship made to fix every other ship around the world. It's a ship they could build a new cabin for the captain.
Sure.
So the woodworking shop was amazing, full of tools of this size and bigger. You know, this scale. This is a real massive tool, and I had to hire a logger on Oahu to go over there with me with the right rigging tools so we could unbolt it from the room that it was in, wheel it down the hallway or whatever they call the it was on the fifth deck.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to get it over the edge with ropes and lower it down to a waiting skiff below it.
Oh,
without it falling. And the guy, and this is the only part the Navy would help, would only bring the skiff out and under it when we had it 6 inches above his.
Oh, jeez.
Because otherwise, if we dropped it, of course, it would go right through the boat.
Yeah.
One ton. I'm not exaggerating. This is a one-ton tool. So anyway, that was years ago. And I just got it running this year.
What?
It was missing a couple of little parts.
Oh.
And it's a three-phase motor, and we tried doing it some other way, and finally we got it hooked up. So it's running great. And man, it is a pleasure to use. It's almost worth all the trouble I went through. By the way, the $200 tool ended up being about a $3,000 tool by the time I was done.
Yeah.
Not even figuring my time. But this is about a $7,000 or $8,000 tool if you went to buy it. And incidentally, you can't buy one of this quality anymore.
Anymore?
This is not that old.
Yeah.
But it was made in America. And you cannot, with all of our EPA standards for making things and polluting the air and everything else, you can't do this in America anymore. So now it's done in Brazil or China or all the other places. And why that matters is because when they were doing this, this company, a very good company, an American company, was taking their time in curing the cast iron after they would make the pieces. They would let it cure. It's like almost like wood.
Huh.
And then they would re-mill them flat. Okay. They don't necessarily take that kind of time in China these days or wherever they're being made. So you often end up with a tool that's slightly warped or slightly out.
Oh,
not
really?
Always, but you can.
Yeah.
And this is the most important tool to have not slightly warped, because it's make things straight.
Yeah.
Okay. So sure. if it's not really, really true, like this one, isn't really, really true.
Mm-hmm.
It works just fine, to be honest with you. But if you want to make something that's 12 feet long and straight as a drop of rain might fall, then you want this.
Mm.
So anyway, that's a story for how I ended up with this thing. It'll probably be buried with me, or I'll be buried under it or something. God knows what. It's not leaving this workshop, I don't think, anytime
well,
soon.
Well, I wish we had more time, more than a half hour to explore your man cave, if you will. It's a wonderful, wonderful place. But we're running out of time, and I sure appreciate you allowing us to come in and,
my pleasure.
And discover maybe a few of your secrets. And Antiques Boutique is the shop on Baldwin, right across from the Makawa Steakhouse. And you can see, hopefully, a few pieces of yours.
Yeah, usually there's
there.
Pieces of
But it's a wonderful shop anyway. And if people wanted to commission you, how would they go about doing that?
Well, they would call me up, actually, on the phone.
Oh, really? You have a landline.
I have a landline. And the Kingswood shop is in the phone book, or my name is also in the phone book. And it's actually a process. You call up and you want something made. We actually begin the conversation with, of course, what are you looking for? And what style are you interested in? And what do you have in your house? And it usually ends up being a house visit. And napkin sketches, and then it works on to be real drawings and choice of woods. And
so it's a long process.
It can be.
It's not
it doesn't usually happen that quickly. Thing. It's it'll be at least a matter of months, usually, if not a few more than that.
But worth the wait, though. Your work is so beautiful.
Thank you, Bill.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, thank you again, Peter Naramore, for your work that you do. You brighten up our lives. You make the world seem more beautiful. I'm Bill Best with On Exhibit, Carl Rozicki behind the camera, and thanks to Larry John as well. And we will catch up with you another time, maybe in the music studio with your handmade guitar.
Sounds good. Okay, thank you, Bill. Thank you for coming by.
Aloha.